relativistic universe overturns our familiar world through three uncanny features: length contraction, time dilation, and especially, the relativity of simultaneity. Each disrupts our intuition through several unsettling paradoxes. Let us examine the simplest one, the length contraction paradox. We consider, as before, a circular lab at rest in a stationary inertial frame, and another, identical lab in a moving inertial frame. As seen from the stationary frame, the moving lab appears to shrink along the direction of motion due to relativistic length contraction. When the two labs pass each other, the moving lab seems to fit entirely inside the stationary lab. But from the moving lab's point of view, the stationary lab also appears to undergo length contraction by exactly the same factor. And now, when the two labs pass each other, the stationary lab seems to fit entirely inside the moving lab as well. According to our non-relativistic logic, the two situations cannot occur simultaneously. But they do. So, how can both views be simultaneously correct? The answer lies in the way we perceive extended objects in relativistic motion. In the non-relativistic everyday world, we tend to think of moving objects in terms of instantaneous snapshots. When we take a picture of a moving object, we assume that every part of it is recorded at the same instance of time, both from our point of view and from the object's point of view. In the larger, relativistic world, this assumption is no longer correct due to relativity of simultaneity. As seen from the stationary frame, each plane of the moving frame, that is perpendicular to the direction of motion, is observed at a different proper time, flowing at a time-dilated rate. In fact, the rearmost point of the moving lab is always observed at a later instance of proper time than its foremost point. This means that at each instance of our time, we see moving objects, not as instantaneous snapshots, but as veritable spacetime cross-sections across a continuum of snapshots, in their proper time. Our previous discussion on the underpinnings of length contraction introduced this fundamental feature of relativistic motion by means of a pair of color-coded clocks. The cross-section is determined by the moving frame's relative speed, and so, different frames see different space-time cross-sections. The length contraction paradox arises because the two labs observe each other according to different space-time cross-sections in different inertial frames. To understand whether either lab really fits entirely into the other, let us look at this phenomenon in a slightly different way. First, let us visualize space-time cross-sections by attaching to each lab a graph of the proper time differential along the direction of motion, relative to its foremost point. The graph of the stationary lab is just a horizontal line, since all its points are observed at the same proper time. But the graph of the moving lab is a slanted line, with the non-zero slope. Let us call this slope the time slope. It represents the variation of proper time, in the moving frame, as observed along the direction of motion, in the stationary frame. For a uniformly moving frame, the time slope is constant, and depends only on the frame's relative velocity along the direction of motion. In relativistic units, it is exactly proportional to the negative of the relative velocity, by the factor of time dilation. As we expect, when the relative speed slows to zero, the time slope vanishes too. Let us call a spacetime cross-section with vanishing time slope, an instantaneous spacetime cross-section. Now we can say that, in the length contraction paradox, we are essentially trying to compare an instantaneous spacetime cross-section of zero time slope with the non-instantaneous one of finite time slope. Yet, the only way we know to reliably compare object lengths is by means of instantaneous snapshots, or just the same, by means of instantaneous space-time cross-sections. In the relativistic world, however, we must extend our comparison to non-instantaneous space-time cross-sections. But how should we do it? To gain an intuitive image in three dimensions, let us confine our world, temporarily, to a single two-dimensional plane. And let us consider first a single, arbitrary moment of time, as seen in the stationary frame. As before, each point of the moving frame is seen at a different proper time. But now, we can visualize this feature using the third dimension. We assign each point of each object in the two-dimensional world a third coordinate equal to its proper time as observed in the stationary frame. All points of the stationary lab have the same proper time. Therefore, the stationary lab is just displaced along the third dimension by a distance corresponding to the stationary time. The moving lab, on the other hand, becomes tilted along the direction of motion at a slope exactly equal to the time slope. It so happens that the time slope tilt exactly compensates for length contraction along the direction of motion. So, in the new tilted space-time position, the moving lab length scale appears as seen at rest in the moving frame itself. We can think of this view as an instantaneous snapshot of the moving frame space-time as seen at a given moment in the stationary frame. Let us call the overall picture, obtained this way, a proper time diagram. It is different from, and should not be confused with, a regular space-time diagram. If we follow consecutive proper time diagrams, built for consecutive times in the stationary frame, we see the moving lab sliding both along the direction of motion at the rate of its relative velocity, and in proper time, at a time dilated rate. The two displacements compound in such a way that the overall direction of motion in spacetime is exactly perpendicular to the tilted plane of the moving lab itself. The rate of motion along this spacetime trajectory turns out to be exactly the normal time rate as seen in the stationary frame. That is, the moving lab, undistorted, slides at the regular time rate along a tilted time direction. At the same time, the stationary lab also slides along the proper time axis at the same normal rate. So, in a proper time diagram, the moving and stationary labs slide past each other, undistorted and at the same rate, along different time directions that are at an angle to each other in spacetime. This is a straightforward way to show that the moving and stationary labs are observed according to different spacetime cross-sections. As in a regular spacetime diagram, we can retrieve the two-dimensional worldview as seen from the stationary frame by looking down in an orthogonal projection along the time axis. Now, we can say that the stationary two-dimensional worldview is just an orthographic view along the proper time axis of two identical labs moving at an angle to each other in spacetime. To retrieve the moving frame view, we should construct a new proper time diagram for the moving frame. However, the moving frame diagram turns out to be just like the stationary one, only rotated so that the moving frame time direction becomes the new proper time axis. This means that we can retrieve the moving frame view simply by projecting along the time direction of the moving frame. But this is just another orthographic view of the two labs as seen along the time direction of the moving frame. We can say that the two labs see each other in different space-time cross-sections because they observe different time orthographic views along different space-time directions. So, does either lab become smaller than the other along the direction of motion? Not really. Only their observed space-time cross-sections do, because they see each other at different space-time angles in their respective time orthographic views of space-time. We can say that the length contraction paradox arises simply because we lack proper time depth perception. To navigate the relativistic world, we must learn to find and properly interpret what we may call proper time depth cues. Until then, we can see if the two labs are really of different size or not, as at rest, if we view them both at the same space-time angle. That is, we can properly compare them only when their space-time cross-sections have time slopes of the same magnitude. Our non-relativistic way of comparing instantaneous space-time cross-sections corresponds to vanishing time slopes. But in the relativistic world, we can also compare non-instantaneous cross-sections. We can do so by observing the two labs from a third reference frame, one that sees both of them moving at the same relative speed, but in different directions. Since time slope magnitude depends only on a lab speed relative to the observer, but not on its direction of motion, the two labs will appear in cross-sections of identical size, if, and only if, they are identical in size, at rest. The relativistic universe overturns our familiar world in uncanny ways, but it is within our grasp, after all.